Now go on to our next speaker, Dr. Sumita Agarkar, who is going to be talking on managing pediatric cataracts. A very special thank you, doctor, for chipping in and giving a boost to our webinar. She is the Deputy Director of Pediatric Ophthalmology Department of Shankar Netralaya, Chennai, a vibrant, skilled surgeon and the most pleasant personality who has led the pediatric department to great heights under her able guidance. Academically, she has soared in her achievements with a huge presence in the national and international conferences and many publications to her credit. And we look forward to learning a lot from you about infantile cataracts. On to you, Dr. Sumita.
Good evening. Are my slides visible?
Yes, visible, audible.
Thank you for such a kind introduction. And I'm feeling very, very large shoes of Dr. Sudarshan here. So, please bear with me if I'm not up to the mark. So it is one of the commonest causes of treatable blindness, and this is what has been reported in literature. Of course, this is probably much more in developing countries like ours, where there is data is very scanty and very irregular. And we must remember that these children are visually impaired for a very long time, and it has definitely a socioeconomic aspect to it in reference to countries like ours. Now, if you come to the etiology, it's basically into four large groups there. Idiopathic, which is still the largest. Now, idiopathic does not mean there is no cause, but probably we don't know the cause at this point. And with new next generation sequencing and the other genetic markers, probably a lot more cataracts are going to move into inherited category from idiopathic. In our country, intrauterine infections form a very large part of cataracts, and you probably should pay attention to looking at careful history. A small percentage of them are metabolic disorders. Coming quickly to management, probably the mainstay of management is probably surgery, but non-surgical treatment or dilating drops can be used for small anterior opacities or peripheral opacities, which are measuring less than 3 millimeters, which can be watched or even given dilating drops. So this patient, like if I see this patient I've been watching for past 4 years with 6-9 vision, does have a cataract, but this probably does not require surgery. So despite several controversies surrounding cataracts in children, I think these are some things which we all agree on, that we need to manage them very aggressively if it is visually significant. Not only surgery, surgery is just a beginning of a very, very long road of towards vision. So these are the technical challenges when we look at the children. Their eyes are smaller, shallower anterior chambers, very low scleral rigidity, and positive pressure. And of course, the inflammatory response is much, much more in children and unpredictable also. So most important technical point in doing cataract surgeries in children is probably anterior capsular axis. Capsule is very elastic. It has a tendency to run off, and often the red glow is absent. That makes it far more difficult. So here the pearls are that you should aim for probably a smaller axis than what you intend to have. You should probably use a cohesive viscoelastic, though I have used in dispersive viscoelastics like Viscomet also. Capsular staining has been the game changer in pediatric cataracts, making it far more easier for almost everybody to do this. And the secret is to always grasp and re-grasp the leading edge of the tear towards center. So force of the pull should be centripetal or towards the center. Like this patient, instrumentation, you can use a Eutrata forceps, you can use a microcapsular forceps like I have been using here. And you can see that my force is always towards the center, and staining makes it so much easier in this patient. And this patient actually has a very large pre-existing posterior capsular rent also there, but staining has made all the difference in this case. But sometimes you can have a very, very tough fibrotic anterior capsule, which makes it very difficult, and you may have to think on your feet to use scissors, and sometimes these can be very tough to cut with a vitrector also, because they are smooth edges. So sometimes you may have to use scissors, and then once you have cut the capsule, then you can use a vitrector, because now the edges are kind of roughened, and now you can use a vitrector to cut this. Just putting the vitrector down, face down on this cutting side down, will not help you cut the capsule, this kind of capsules. So you may have to use other methods. And as you can see, as long as you stay in that fibrosed capsular edge, you are safe from extension and you are probably going to be fairly, you can make it adequate size capsule with your vitrector. And you can do a posterior capsulotomy as well as you can put the lens also fairly safely without risk of extension in these patients. So posterior capsule management, again, there are PCO rates are 100% in children. Younger the children, earlier is the PCO. Amblyopia is a concern. And PCO can undo your beautifully done surgery within few weeks or few months. So it is mandatory in younger children. And again, here manual PCC is probably a gold standard. Ideal size should be around 3.5 to 4. And you can approach it either limbal or you can even go pars plana if you're confident of making a pars plana entry and going behind the, after putting the lens, going behind and doing it. You can also probably do a posterior capsular management following putting the lens, which several people are very good at and can be done very safely with the newer 23 gauge vitrectomies. Probably it's far less challenging than it was earlier. As I said, intact hyaloid phase acts like a scaffold. So vitrectomy is again mandatory probably in children who are infants or younger children. Above 7 years, you can probably defer vitrectomy. And again, here, I prefer limbal approach, but if you are confident and you have the instrumentation, pars plana vitrectomy is also probably can be considered, especially now with when there's transconjunctival and sutureless tunnels are done. So this is one patient of mine where video is not playing. So let's management when it comes to aphakia, should not, these are your options. One good option for bilateral cataracts is to have aphakic glasses despite IOLs being put in almost 90% of the children who undergo surgery. There are some cases where you may not put the lens, and that cases if the cataract is bilateral, aphakic glasses is a very good option. Lightweight materials are available and can be very easily adjusted as the eye elongates and the refraction changes. And visual outcomes are comparable to both glasses as well as contact lenses. Disadvantages of glasses can be, of course, they are heavy and produce optical aberrations. Optical quality is poor and cannot be used for unilateral cataracts. Contact lenses, again, in unilateral cases, that's our only option. Rigid gas permeables are better. Though I have silicone lenses are expensive and easy to use, but probably they are. So advantages again here are over the, they are equally good as contact lenses. There is no induced magnification and visual long-term outcomes are probably comparable. Difficulties with contact lenses, again, intolerance, availability, cost, and parents sometimes find it very difficult to manage contact lenses. IOLs, yes, it is tricky, slightly tricky, especially when you are talking about children who are very young. So it's probably standard of care above 1 year of age. It is not so clear question as it in infants. Definitely higher rates of complications and reoperations in infants and microphthalmic eyes. And unilateral cataracts do better with early IOL implantation, according to this 1988 paper, as early as that. So in older children above 1 year, probably it's not such a question, but in infants, it is still complicated. With infant aphakia treatment study, which basically looked at in unilateral cataracts and relatively smaller eyes, probably they found much higher rates of reoperations, much higher rates of adverse events, as well as resurgery rates, which were very high for children who underwent IOL implantation compared to those who were left aphakic. But probably with all things said and done and all evidence collected, probably in 2020, putting an IOL in an infant probably is an anatomical decision rather than age of the child per se. That is a factor, but you really need to consider the anatomical diameter, anatomical conditions like corneal diameter, which should be at least 10 millimeters or more. An axial length of at least 18 millimeters or more. you should have adequate surgical skills to manage these children, because they are relatively difficult even among children. And I would even add a good dilatation as a criteria, because sometimes poor dilatation is very common in very small infants with smaller eyes, and it makes your surgery really miserable if the dilatation is poor. Again, absence of comorbidities like glaucoma or structural abnormalities is definitely also a factor to be considered. And I would also add ability of the parents to follow up these patients is also a criteria before you put an infant. So IOL in an infant. I'm talking about infancy, I mean 6 months, under 6 months of age. I think older children, probably these criteria do not apply as much. Material, I have put this as a technical issue. All these lenses are available, but I think there is no question in 2020 that acrylic hydrophobic lenses work best, and that has been the single most game changer in pediatric cataracts as far as the adverse events and the inflammation is considered. To the extent that if I see an inflammatory reaction on the next day, I think more in terms of really endophthalmitis than in terms of inflammation. It's so rare with hydrophobic acrylic lenses. Power selection in these children, again, there is no perfect formula. There have been, for every formula, there is a rejoinder, and there has been several retrospective studies which have each given a new conflicting reports. But I think SRK2 and Barrett's Universal 2 is probably most commonly used, though there are no studies available with Barrett's Universal 2 in children. But I have been using it and with relatively okay results. But if you are using an older formula like SRK2, it's probably all right. Only thing to remember is that because children have very shorter exit lens, smallest error can get magnified much more than you will find in an adult. Target postoperative refraction. Again, these are the three strategies which you can have, and each has its pluses and minuses. But I think world over, the initial hyperopia is what people go for, because it is easier to titrate, and it can, as I said, children grow older, and it probably kind of titrates out, or you can actually move into emetropia when the children are older. So it is probably still the most preferred approach by most of the pediatric ophthalmologists all over. When is IOL a bad idea? Yes, if there is microcornea and microphthalmos or severe structural abnormalities and IRIDA and all, sometimes you have to be careful about putting IOLs. Some inflammatory entities like GRIC or IOL is still a bad idea. If there is a primary zonular pathology, also again, I would think it is as a relative contraindication, because these children, when you look at 25 years, 30 years, they are bound to have problems with the lenses, although videos and first postoperative day, they look spectacular and beautiful. But you know, when we are doing children surgery in children, you are not looking at next 10 years follow-up, but you're looking at next 25 years of follow-up. Multifocals, I'm putting it here just to complete the discussion, and I'm sure there are some very good cataract surgeons in the panel and they can comment on it. I have personally very little experience with multifocals in children. And these are my points why I am not very comfortable with putting multifocal IOLs in children. Because most important reason for me is there is just not enough long-term data to justify using them in children as yet. Sutured or glued IOL, again, some cases of ectopia lentis and inadequate PC support, you may think of these two options. Again, better to be avoided in very young children. Good vitrectomy is very, very essential. And suture breakage and decentration probably is the biggest problems with these lenses. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. It was a very detailed talk, and it's difficult to compress it into 8 minutes, such an extensive talk. Any question?
I have a few comments to make. One thing is, as Dr. Sumita rightly mentioned, staining has made the life very easy. It not only improves the visibility, but it also changes the texture of the capsule, so it makes the access easier. And for the postgraduates, I would like to mention that if you don't have access to an automated vitrector, please do not do a pediatric cataract surgery, because the anterior vitrectomy is the most important part of pediatric cataract surgery till the age of 7 years. So without that, pediatric surgery is as good as not doing the surgery, because the PCO rate, as Dr. Sumita said, it will be 100% and the opacification is quite dense. And the other important thing is you have to always suture these wounds, particularly in children below 7 years.
Yes, I
should. It's always better to suture these wounds because the low scleral rigidity, it tends to open up and you have flat ACs. And other important, the last thing I would like to highlight is surgery is only 50% of the job done. The rest of the thing is follow-up for the amblyopia, glaucoma, retinal issues. So that follow-up is extremely important in these, and it's not like an adult cataract surgery. So any other comments from Dr. Rohit?
I just had one question. Systemic evaluation in a child for a cataract surgery.
Sorry, ma'am.
When would you plan a systemic evaluation when you are taking up a child?
I think the most important things which you should probably see when there is a child who walks in with cataract is, one is examine the parents, because it is very, very important there. And if parents have, one of the parents has, then actually you should not do anything, because most of the metabolic disorders are autosomal recessive and are unlikely to come from the parents. So that is the autosomal dominant cataracts, most of them. And probably if you see evidence of cataract surgery in parents or cataract in parents, then probably you should not worry about too much about metabolic disorders, number one. Number two, if there is an obvious facial dysmorphism or short stature or other features, then probably systemic evaluation makes it worthwhile. If you see a subluxation, mental retardation, all these associated features probably are required for. Like Down syndrome is very commonly associated with cataract. So in that case, diagnosis is more or less certain by the time patient walks in. You don't need a major evaluation. But certain conditions can have implications for anesthesia also, general anesthesia also. So I think it's a good idea as a part of preoperative evaluation to have a good pediatric evaluation, as well as if there is something which you really see in facial features or something, then direct it accordingly.
Thank you.
Madam, I had a quick question, and also to all the panelists. You said putting IOL is a bad idea in case of microophthalmos or microcornea, but few of the surgeons are still trying about the customized IOL in putting for the microophthalmos to improve the vision. So I just wanted your and panel opinion on this.
I think Jitendra is here, and Jitendra is one of the biggest users of customized lenses and probably has some experience with that, but only problem with customized lenses, which I find, is that they are not foldable as yet. So yes, you end up requiring a fairly big incision. Yeah, so in a 5 millimeter incision in an 8 millimeter cornea is actually like you're almost doing half keratoplasty. Yeah. So I would a little bit, I'm hesitant about that. And often microophthalmos and all have lots of angle dysgenesis and sometimes very narrow angles and a lot of prone for glaucoma, but so I don't put it. But these are my issues with customized lenses, because they are not yet foldable.
Yeah, so I would yes, ma'am. So the customized IOL, I don't put it normally as a primary procedure. So what happens is that most of the microcornea cases, as they say that microcornea patients are more susceptible to glaucoma, and there is wonderful work done by Dr. Mayuri Khamar on the ciliary body and UBM of microcornea patients. So the point being that we do surgery, we leave it aphakic, and then try to treat aphakia, and we wait. So once they are around 5 to 6 years of age, we do implant a customized IOL. I think we have done more than 100 customized IOLs by now, which includes the Aurolab pediatric IOL also. So basically, Aurolab pediatric IOL we use because it is much cheaper compared to customized IOL. But that is, then most of these cases are secondary IOL implantations, not really primary IOL implantations. So the threat, real threat of, you see that, this patient is not going for glaucoma. So that's how we try to circumvent that thing.
I think when they are
a little older, risk of glaucoma, very true.
And I think when they are a little older, like 5 to 6 years, you can probably get away with a three-piece foldable lens also, compared if you don't have access to customized lens, you can probably put, but not as a primary procedure in a very young infant.
Customized IOLs are made in India. You have access to customized IOLs. Yeah. You can easily get them. No. Yeah, the incision is little bigger. I know your concern is not about the procurement of the lens, but rather the size of
what
the wound.
Let me ask you one question. What is the smallest diameter cornea which you have used a customized lens?
I've used it in 8.25, madam. The optic size we used was 4 millimeters.
Yeah,
4 millimeters optic size. So in customized, you can actually reduce the optic size also, because the wound size has to be smaller. Yes. Mm-hmm.